Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing this Sunday morning? Hopefully well. My name is Javier Blanco. I'll be your host today. And next to me is...
Jacob Sutterbo.
Jacob Sutterbo. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Jacob.
Well, I'll be performing as Jason's wife, Michelle, today.
Well,
and,
okay.
I've been going to Copperfield since about 2012, I think. And we actually started in the McDonald's small group, so...
And you're still here?
I'm still here.
That's amazing. Yeah. The McDonald's are traveling to Ohio, so let's wish them safe travels there, safe travels back. They'll be gone through most of November, if not all of November, so you'll be stuck with myself, possibly Jacob, depending on the schedule.
Depending how this goes today.
Depending on how this goes today, right? You might just not have Virtual Atrium at all. We're kidding. So Virtual Atrium is a place where you can come, whether you're here or at home, online, whatever, to be with us. And it starts at 10:35. You have a countdown. We'll come on at 10:40. And then we'll service starts at 11. So I see Jack is on. Steve Quesada is on. Good morning, guys. Miss Mary McLeod Brock. I haven't had the opportunity to meet you yet, but hello. And oh yeah, my girl Renata. Hey girl, how are you? Good morning. So you had a question this morning, a key question.
Yeah, so Halloween was last night. I was thinking...
Before you go into your question though.
Okay.
Did you guys go trick-or-treating?
My kids did, but I stayed home to scare children.
You did. Did you dress up?
Yes, I did.
What'd you dress up as?
So it was basically one of those black morph suits, and then I had a scary mask on top of that.
Is that so they don't come back next year, or did you just enjoy that?
Well, last year I did the scarecrow effect, where I pretended to be like a scarecrow and then scared them when they
like in the bush, or
no, just leaning against the wall like that.
Okay.
So this year I put that same mask and leaned it up against the wall, but instead I just ran to our window because I funneled them in front of our window. Near the dining room,
right?
And I said, "There's a table, and there's a sign that said contactless candy this way." So they funneled right in front of that window, and then I come up and scare them right there.
Man, so you put like a lot of effort into your Halloweens. It's your thing, huh?
Yeah, that's
awesome.
It.
Yeah, I wish I had that kind of energy for Halloween. 4 kids later, man. So go ahead.
My question was: when I was a kid, I remember being a pirate like 3 or 4 years in a row, and that was my go-to Halloween costume.
Okay.
And I was just wondering, for those out there, when you were a kid, if you did Halloween, what was your go-to Halloween costume?
What was your go-to Halloween costume? Jack, what was your go-to Halloween costume? Post it on there, we want to know.
What was yours?
Mine? Well, so I grew up in Venezuela, as most of y'all know, and my mom had to make a lot of my Halloween costumes. So a costume that she made me was a pirate, and she painted my face green. So I don't know if I was a sick pirate, like seasick pirate or something.
Yeah.
And it's actually on Facebook, it's pretty funny. And so I teased her about it, and then she claims that she made those costumes that one year we lived in the States when we were kids. But she made my sister Miss Piggy and my brother a pumpkin, and it was all homemade.
Were they painted pink and orange?
They were not. She actually had a mask, like a full Miss Piggy. But my favorite childhood Halloween costume was when my mom, this was in Venezuela, dressed me up as a mummy. Okay? Mm-hmm. So she wrapped me in some kind of cloth. I think she ripped up a bed sheet or something, wrapped me up in it. I'm at a school party as a mummy. And what happens when you have to use a restroom? Okay, and your mom is not there. Right? So I go into the restroom. Now I'm stuck in the bathroom with nothing on, waiting for my mom to come back and pick me up, and didn't even get to enjoy the party. So I was the mummy.
So you like hid in the bathroom?
I hid in the bathroom. Well, yeah, I was like 6 years old. What was I supposed to do? You know? So yeah, I was in the bathroom, dressed up as a mummy.
Nice. So I was just thinking, you know, as a parent, from the parent end now, it's like if a kid has a go-to costume they want to be every Halloween, you're like, great. So I, you know, Stella, oh, you want to be a princess again? All right, well, what do you want to be this year? Belle, Cinderella, Sophia, just we'll open the closet and they go and pick one.
Thousands of different costumes, yeah. my kids dressed up, you know, as every princess. My daughter, Remington, she dressed up as a meme what's the anime character?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really know the character name, but she painted her face
up.
I
can't help you there either.
Yeah, it's like, I can't keep up with the animes and all this stuff, but she had a wig and she looked great. She went to school like that. So I asked her, I was like, were you the only one? She's like, yeah, but I was the coolest one. So I was like, okay, I like your confidence. So that was it. So,
are your kids still dressing up?
They dress up every day, year round.
Okay.
That's kind of what they do. That's what kids do. I mean, we have a closet upstairs where they have all their Halloween costumes from year past.
Yeah.
And they
do too.
Dress up. I mean, they play dress up all day. I have to sometimes play dress up, if you believe it or not. That's why I grew my hair out so I could be a pretty princess this year. Just didn't get out long enough.
You got some time.
Yeah, I do. I do. So,
Tape face.
Yeah, so Jack said that he dressed up as season 4 of America's Got Talent. I don't know what that is, Jack. What do you mean? Like, you dress up as the whole America's Got Talent? Like, every character in America's Got Talent? Or is Tape Face a person? Do you understand what he's saying?
I do not know.
Okay.
I do not know.
Okay.
Steve has an unfortunate story about not having a costume. Sorry about that, Steve.
That was a... what? Yeah, we can't repeat that, Steve. Okay? You're going to have to keep those comments. Pam will cut us off if we repeat your stories. So, we apologize. Jack said you scared me. I don't know who he's talking to. So...
And then June this year was Descendants Mal, which, if you don't have kids, you probably don't know. Descendants is a Disney show where it's basically all the princes and bad guys' kids
mm-hmm.
are growing up and going to high school and whatnot. And I think Mal is Maleficent's daughter.
They're battling. Yeah, my kids, my daughter Lila actually loves that movie.
Yeah.
She's had birthday parties at home where they watch all the series of those movies
mm-hmm.
together, and it's actually pretty cool. But so I mean you have girls, do you get in your car and sing like Maleficent songs with them or princess music with them?
They definitely make requests. We have a playlist on Amazon Prime called June and Stella, and there's some princess songs on there for sure.
Okay.
And sometimes Stella likes to freestyle and just make up words
yeah.
and songs.
So Tanya will say that I do that just because I make up my own songs, but I do like to sing the Moana song. Like the it's an amazing. So every time we get in the car, it's a jam session with me and my girls, right? So we sing Moana, we do the dance, you know. I mean, since
you dance
well
in the car?
Well, I do, since I kind of look like The Rock, you know. We're built the same anyways.
You look almost exactly like The Rock, like now that I think about it.
Yeah, maybe the hair. I think we had the same muscle.
Yeah, the same
tone,
build.
The same build, yeah. We work at the same gym, so it's pretty amazing. What are you doing for Thanksgiving? You guys staying here, going out?
Yes, I believe we're staying here, and I believe some family's going to come and visit.
Okay.
So.
From Corpus?
From Rockport area.
Rockport.
Yeah.
You're from Rockport, not Corpus. Is there a difference?
I am from Rockport. Corpus is 45 minutes away. That's
okay.
The closest city to Rockport.
Yeah. So the only reason why I know Corpus is because I think I've told you this. When we moved to the States, I lived in Cal Island for a year.
Yep. I don't like Cal Island.
You don't? It's
they
like
beat
a
us,
rival?
They beat us bad in football.
Well, we're pretty
often.
Awesome. For the 1 year I was there.
Yeah,
awesome.
You made it what it is today.
I made it what it was.
Yeah.
Never played American football in my life and came there and we just all of a sudden were magical. So it was pretty awesome.
All right.
Yeah. So so they're coming to town and you guys doing a full feast, the whole...
Yeah, I believe so. Last year we did fajitas instead of turkey. We're not the biggest fans of turkey, except my father-in-law smoked turkey, and we can't swing that. So we did fajitas and people enjoyed it. So
I think Tanya would enjoy coming to your house for Thanksgiving. She has to have turkey for Thanksgiving. That's what it is. She cannot not do turkey. Because her family did fajitas 1 year for turkey, and she's like, or for Thanksgiving, and she's like, I'm not coming over if we're not doing that. So kind of leads to November 15th, you know, here at church, we're doing a little worship gathering.
Grateful in the Green.
Yeah, so I don't know when your family is coming in or not, but it's a time to invite family and friends, your neighbors. Just come on, hang out. I think the church is going to be providing hamburgers and, you know, a lunch. Some food is from 2 to 4.
Yes,
11 to
2,
sorry. 11 to 2.
Listening here that doesn't go to Copperfield, you are also welcome.
Absolutely.
And, you know, invite your neighbors. Should be a good time.
Yeah, we're going to be outside in the lawn. You said the name, right? Grateful on the Green?
Grateful on the Green.
Which means grateful on the grass, I think. Was that what they got out of that?
I think so.
Yeah, that's pretty creative. I'm pretty sure Pam probably came up with that.
She's the marketing guru.
She is the most creative person at Copperfield.
She's shaking her head.
She's
laughing.
Shaking her head. She's, yeah. She
can't believe it.
I'm fired.
Yeah. Yeah. Might cut to black hair in just a second.
So, yeah. So, Grateful on the Green. Come out. Bring chairs. Bring blankets. Weather should hopefully be amazing like it is today. We'll be worshiping together. Just... hanging out, you know, we just want to meet our neighbors, reach our people, and just be together in this time in this year where, you know, we're all so poofed up or cuffed up into our homes where we can't get out. So we'll have some social distancing and we'll be outside.
Yeah, and if you missed Sunday Fun Day, this would be a great chance to come out. And again, Sunday Fun Day, had a great time. Social distancing outside,
yes.
You know, less likely to spread outside, so.
I think Sunday Fun Day is actually how you and I got to be on here.
Yeah, you recruited me there.
Is that what happened?
Yeah.
Yeah, so come out number 15 so I can recruit you. You can come sit next to me. Jason will be gone, so I'll do the Jason, what Jason does, this right here. So, details.
And I'll do the Michelle.
Oh, Jason, you're the best.
Not another dad joke.
Those two are awesome. We definitely miss them. This is so natural for Jason.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm working here.
We can't get up to that level.
No, we're going to try, though. We're going to try. We're going to try, Jason, if you're watching. If you watch at some point. All the details for that Grape on the Green will be online. So if we miss something or if you need to know more about it, it'll be on there. It is from 11 to 2. I said the time wrong earlier. Just want to make sure I get that across to you guys. And then also, you know, we had that Lake Charles trip of last week or a week and a half ago. We have a potential another one coming up soon.
Yes, I believe. And Eric is helping lead that. And they're thinking maybe November 14th. If you're ready and willing to make a trip out to Lake Charles and help out, that's what it's looking like. So keep on the lookout on the website and on Copperfield Facebook page to see when that actual date is. And I'm sure we can use your help if you have gifts of mucking or helping out with houses or just visiting with people. They'd be happy to have you. So.
Awesome. Yeah, Jack's going to be there. He just texted us that he's coming on. So always happy to have Jack there with us.
Yeah.
What else? What else is going on?
So Grateful on the Green, did we mention, so there's a registration link, you can bring a dessert, sign up to bring a dessert,
okay.
And then you can either pay for your meal, pay for extra meals, or don't pay for any meals at all, so it's up to you.
Okay. Yeah, we'll have some games, it'll be fun. If you bring a soccer ball, I mean, we have a huge yard out here, so bring soccer balls. Last, at the Sunday Fun Day, we played, had a little mod volleyball game going on. I had to show, Eric, what's up, and his crew. Hunter and I actually, we started playing tennis right after that, so it's good places to kind of meet people and see what they like and start engaging outside of these organized activities. Hunter and I play tennis now every week, either Monday or Tuesday, so it's been fun, got back into it. It's been about 25 years since I played, so.
Yeah, tennis is a tough one to get back into.
Did you play?
I played in junior high, just a little bit.
That's not really playing. That's like saying, like, you know, I went to the movies once.
Okay, I dabbled in tennis.
Thank you. There you go. Yeah, no, I played tennis from the age of 4 till I graduated high school. And then joined the military. I think I tried playing once in the military and just wasn't fun. And then that was it.
Switch to ping pong because you don't have to run around.
I did switch to ping pong. I had to be the Copperfield champ at ping pong, but.
Oh, is that
I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm sort of a big deal in the ping pong world, okay?
I didn't know there was a tournament or a championship here.
There used to be.
I missed
be.
That.
There
I missed that on the Copperfield page.
There used to be. Austin Brewer started coming up a little bit, but he, you know, I had to put him in his place a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you play ping pong?
Yeah, just a little bit. We have a ping pong table at work. I must be rusty now because I haven't been at work since March, but, you know.
I have one in my house, so... Anytime when you're feeling froggish, sleep, man.
All right.
Yeah, come on over.
Okay. Gotcha. Thanks for the offer.
You got it, buddy. Open invitation. So Jason and I went to go play golf last week. And I was kind of afraid because he was telling me stories about his golf adventures where he does 360s and like drives.
His driving. I've heard about this.
Yeah.
Also.
Kind of like tries to drive in the cars into the lake or knocking people out of the golf cart.
And I hear he slaloms through the trees.
He does. Yeah, he does. Mm-hmm. But since this was a private golf course and is one that he's a member of, he had to be in his best behavior. So we actually had a great time. And it started off a little rainy, cold. It got beautiful for about 45 minutes, and then it got really cold after that. So we played 17 holes. Skipped.
What?
Yeah, we skipped.
Why not finish?
Oh, we skipped 17. We went straight to 18. It was getting a little dark. It was getting real cold. I could barely feel my fingers at that point.
Okay.
All
right.
So it was time. But we had fun. I actually figured out a lot about my my game that day.
That is not good?
That is not good. And why I should probably practice more. But I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to go waste money on the golf course and, you know, try not to hit a house maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. I think if I'm going to golf for real, I'm going to have to top golf to make sure I'm less of a fool out there.
That's where you're going to go practice at Topgolf?
Yeah. Yeah. That's
okay.
My plan.
That's
yeah.
Your coach. Topgolf is your coach.
Pretty much. Yeah. Try to, you know, get the little points. And I heard they have Angry Birds at Topgolf now.
Do
so.
They?
Yeah. Yeah.
I haven't been in a while. Do you golf?
It's been a long time since I've did the for real golf.
Do you own golf clubs?
I inherited golf clubs, so yes, I do.
I think that's how we all started.
Yeah.
I bought my first set like 2 years ago, and they're amazing. It's awesome. So, let's see. Jack, tell me that Venezuela meal to cook. Well, there's so many, Jack. We don't just eat one meal in Venezuela. I mean, look at me. Do I look like I've missed a meal? You're probably talking about arepas, maybe. Is it a cornbread type deal? Cut in half, put some cheese, and, you know, we eat it for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. You can come talk to me afterwards, but is that the one you're talking about? Or an empanada? Which empanadas can be universal, you know, I mean.
He says sounds good, so I think everything you're saying sounds good.
Oh, okay.
He'll take yes to all the other.
Everything. Well, he does eat like 3-pound burgers once a month or something at this burger joint.
The competition.
That competition he does. Yeah. Thank you. 2-minute countdown. I guess we're not supposed to say that out loud.
You rookie.
Yeah, I'm a rookie.
Jason would never.
Where are you, Jason? He would never do that. I just, you know, we're going there.
So cool. So Jack wins these competitions, gets his shirt.
I don't know if he wins these competitions,
okay.
But he does it a lot, I feel. So, okay. Jack, do you win?
If you got it,
answer. I guess so. So what we look forward to seeing you guys Sunday, November 15th. We'll keep you posted on the Lake Charles. We will be cutting off here for about a minute and moving over to the live service. So hang tight. We'll be, you know, it'll go to a 1-minute countdown and we'll come back, give a little bit of announcements and then see you in about a minute. Goodbye. Wow.
Good timing.
Good timing. Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Javier Blanco here. Welcome to Copperfield Church Sunday morning. Glad to have everybody here. Next to me is handsome fella.
Jacob Sutterbow. I'm playing Michelle McDonald, Jason's lovely wife today.
Yes. So it's a little change in pace.
Not as good, sorry.
Not as good, not as funny, not as mobile.
No.
But we'll do the best we can. So a couple announcements to go through. So Sunday, November 15th, 2020, from 11 to 2, we're going to have a Grateful on the Green. Please come out, join us, and worship with us.
Invite your friends.
Invite your friends, invite your neighbors, family, the person down the road from work. Bring everybody. It's going to be fun. We're going to have games and just hang out and worship. We're gonna have some food there for everybody. Bring a blanket. Bring some chairs, and go online and look for the details.
And then also, Eric has talked about this previously at the virtual atrium, but we have taken a trip to Lake Charles. His team has and worked over there, and they're gonna do that again. And it's looking like maybe November 14th. So be on the lookout for the updates on that, and hopefully if you can help out, you can come with the team and help out those that need it over there.
Yeah, awesome. We need you. So now, if everybody could, please stand up, worship with us. Take care.
Jacob, God, we're so excited to come worship you today. I pray that you lead us into worshiping you. God, just show us your love. May it be so great on us today that we can't hold back but from expressing how much we love you back. It's in your name we pray. Amen. My sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested and my life began. Was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. So free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom. So my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, your grace, oh your grace, so free, washes over. Cross and darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Your grace, oh, your grace, so free, washes over.
Oh, could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. Yes, I am a child of God.
Worship. dear Lord, I just ask you to bless us today as we sit here in your presence, Lord, about to hear a message straight from you, God. And I ask that you open our hearts and our minds to you and all that you have to say. And I just thank you so much for allowing us to worship together as one body in you. And it's your name I pray. Amen.
You can take a seat.
Amen. Good to see you this morning. If you are a guest here today, I want to welcome you. We are delighted that you are here. You may have seen it earlier in the service, but there's an option for you to be able to text that you are a guest and let us know. And if you do that, we will embarrass you. Just making sure you're paying attention. No, we won't embarrass you. We will get in touch with you and connect you with other ministries in the context of our congregation here. Just gives us an opportunity to show our appreciation of you being here and then also to make sure that you are connected with the right groups here at Copperfield. If you have any needs, though, it'd be one of the ways to reach out to us, and we would be delighted for you to do so. Also, as another announcement, in 2 weeks, I believe it's November 15th, if my memory serves me correctly, we are going to have Grateful on the Grounds, which we will hold, God willing, go ahead and begin to pray for good weather. We're going to hold out this direction, out in the large field, to my right, your left. We will be eating, fellowshipping together, kind of an abbreviated service. We're still going to have worship, but we're going to hang out from about 11 to 2. And would love for you to participate in that, invite neighbors, guests, great opportunity for you to connect with people that may be looking for some fellowship, especially during this Thanksgiving season. So be mindful of that and put that on your calendar as the day draws near. Well, you may be like most people, if you're anything like me, you've probably hosted an event at your house. You maybe sent out invitations and or you posted something on Facebook, say, hey, everybody meet at the house at this time on this date. And if you are like me in my family, that means that the lead up to everyone showing up is a frantic cleanup, put everything away. Certain rooms have to be cleaned, problems have to be addressed, junk needs to be stored away. Some doors are just completely locked. You get the picture. So whenever you are preparing for company, you get your homes ready for the arrival of a guest. In a similar way, we are anticipating and being ready for the arrival of Christ when he returns to call us home to himself. But the thing about Christ's arrival, Christ showing up, is we don't send out invitations and we don't know the date and time. So this means that we cannot wait until the last few minutes to clean up the junk, to address our problems, to rid ourselves of the issues, and to lock away the areas of our lives that we're ashamed of. We have to be ready for his return. And this is the final message in this series regarding Christian living in a secular age. And this is entitled, that we are to live as Christians in a secular age as citizens awaiting their king. As citizens awaiting their king, that at any given time, the king may knock on the door and arrive. And in this morning's passage, the Apostle Paul deals with this very question. So if you have your Bibles, I would invite you to turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. That's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. And if you don't mind, I would invite you to stand with me out of respect for the reading of the Word of God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, as we consider this idea of Christians living in a secular age as citizens awaiting their king. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, this is what God's word says to us. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that, whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. You may be seated as we go to the Lord and ask his blessing upon the study of his word today. Heavenly Father, I ask that you would bless the preaching of your word. Lord, I pray that, Lord, even as I've been praying most of this morning, Lord, all I can do is sow the seed. I am dependent upon your spirit to break up the hard ground and for you to water it and bring fruit. So, Lord, I ask that you would grant attentive ears, you would grant attentive hearts, Lord, that you would guard me from error, and that you would go before me with your spirit and hold sovereign sway over this gathering. And for the believer, I'm asking, Lord God, that you would embolden us and encourage us with these words. And for those that are still in a drunken stupor of spiritual sleep, I pray that you would wake them up. God, do what you alone can do today. In Christ's holy name, we ask and pray. Amen. Well, I'm going to encourage you to keep your Bible open as we are going to work through this text together this morning as we consider what does it mean to be ready, to be waiting for the King to arrive. If you're taking notes or you have the guide that was provided for you in an email, the first point that you would find is based on verses 1-3, speaking about the details of Jesus' return being unknown. The details of Jesus' return are unknown. What am I speaking about regarding details? Well, it's what Paul mentions in verse 1, so look again with me. Now, concerning the times or the seasons, regarding the times or the dates, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. Why would Paul write that? Because he goes on in verse 2 to tell us, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. So the times and seasons are regarding the coming of the day of the Lord. And we ask, well, what is the coming of the day of the Lord? We do not have the flexibility or the right to get to determine what that means on our own. We have to ask, what did Paul believe it meant? And given the fact that Paul is a Jew who has a deeply rooted sense of the Old Testament, we consider how this language of the day of the Lord is rooted in Old Testament prophetic expectation. I'm going to just kind of give you the bullet points of where you can find this. And this is going to frustrate some of you, and this is going to spark interest in others. This next week, I believe, I'm not going to promise, but I believe this next week, you're going to see our brand new website rolled out. And with our new website, not only are we going to have sermon resources that are available to you in the form of video and audio, but you will then have my notes. So for those of you that are interested in that, you can pick this up at some point next week. But here are a few passages of Scripture that mention the day of the Lord. Isaiah chapter 2, Jeremiah 46, Ezekiel 30, Obadiah 15, Joel 1, 2, Amos 5, Zephaniah 1, and Zechariah 14. This is how that language of the day of the Lord is used. So Paul, as a Jew, is thinking about these prophetic expectations from the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, the day of the Lord referred to the day of reckoning. It was the day when the Lord would settle all accounts. And even though it had this glorious, great hope for full redemption for his people one day, it also carried with it this connotation of the Lord returning and making all things right and judging all wrongs that have not been repented of. It was a somber day. Oftentimes the prophet would use it to motivate the Lord's people to straighten up. The Lord is coming. It kind of reminds me, my mom, who is not watching this right now, but we'll watch this probably sometime next week. She is the faithful watcher of these sermons. She always texts me on Sunday afternoon. And so here's the reality is, if you don't like my sermon, my mom does. She tells me, I get that message almost every Sunday afternoon. So, but one of the things my mom would always kind of tell me, and she was serious about it when I was growing up, is she would ask me, would you want to be listening to that music when the Lord returns? Like, the obvious answer to that is no. And I would sometimes kind of ridicule that idea, like, oh, come on, Mom. But then I realized Paul is kind of calling the church in Thessalonica to say, hey, would you really want to be engaged in that if Jesus showed up today? And the answer is like, well, of course not. And then it's the reminder, well, you don't know when he's showing up. So why would you live with such disregard for his coming if you don't know the day or the time? So Mom was right. You got that one, Mom. So the Old Testament prophets would use it to warn the people that they needed to repent of their sin and their unbelief and ready themselves for the day when the skies would open and the Lord himself would return. And the New Testament authors speak in the same way, except they know that the Lord that's spoken of in the Old Testament is in fact Jesus himself, where it's mentioned in 1 Corinthians 1, 2 Corinthians 1, Philippians 1 and 2. It's mentioned in Romans 2, it's Romans 13, Ephesians 4, and then 2 Timothy 1. It's all over the place. So there's a tendency for me to preach a sermon, and if you're a guest here today, or if you're someone that's been burned by the church, and there are people that have been burned by the church, and you've kind of heard messages that seem to kind of like stir up fear, let me go ahead and tell you this. That's not my goal, is to scare you into doing something today, because fear is a poor motivator, but at the same time, there is a biblical place for warning and perspective. And in this message, while I don't intend to scare you, I intend for the biblical goal of waking you up and sobering you up to happen this morning. I've prayed that all morning long. Awaken people that are asleep today, Lord, and not just dozing off in my sermon. Although that wouldn't hurt. Awaken those who are spiritually asleep and awaken those that are spiritually drunk on the things of this world, that they might see clearly with an expectation that though the details of the Lord's return are unknown, as we're going to see in a moment, the certainty of his return is sure. So for Paul, the church of Thessalonica was already aware that the coming day of the Lord was headed with this ominous tone, and that they should not have a misunderstanding regarding the significance of the day. They should be prepared. They should not be like the world, that when they face trouble, they walk around and they go, peace, security, where there is no peace and there is no security. And here's the reality of what we are seeing right now today in our country, is there are people that are placing their hope for peace and security in what's going to happen on Tuesday. And the reality is God's word would say to us, what makes you think you're going to make it to Tuesday? What makes you think there's going to be an election? Have you somehow peered behind the eternity of God and found out the date and the time? Have you ignored the truth of James 4 that said, you're like that person that says, I'm going to go into the city next week and I'm going to this or that and I'm going to trade and I'm going to make gain. But what if your life is required of you tonight? Or what if just for a moment, that tomorrow morning, Jesus Christ himself parts the sky? Will you be ready? That's what Paul is writing to do. There would have been a temptation in Thessalonica to have been wrapped up in what's happening in Rome, what's happening with Christian persecution. And Paul says, you do realize that history could come to its consummate culmination this evening, and will you be ready? Will you be ready for the day of his return? Will you as a believer recognize that you are not destined to wrath, but to obtain salvation, as we will see later on? We should be ready. We should be awake. We should be sober-minded regarding these realities, because the details of Jesus' return in terms of the date and the time, the season, is unknown. Which moves us to our second point. While the date, the details of Jesus' return are unknown, one of the things that is known is the certainty that he is going to return. So the second point would be the certainty of Jesus' return is known by believers, meaning we ought to know that just as he came one time and he lived and he died and he rose again and he ascended on high, what does he tell his disciples? He will return just as you saw him leave. He's going to return as sure as he is raised from the dead. So we see the certainty of Jesus' return is known by believers, and we find this in verses 4 through 8. Paul reminds the church in Thessalonica in verse 4, you are not in darkness. In other words, you do not lack understanding about the coming of the day of the Lord. It should not surprise you, not because you know when it's going to happen, but that you are living with an anticipation of the return of the King. You do not find security in things other than the Lord, or at least we ought not. Verse 5, we are children of the light, children of the day. Paul's point here is that believers are neither associated with darkness or rebellion, either in their understanding or in their actions. They belong to God, who we know as the Father of light. And because they are children of the light, they, according to verse 6, they do not sleep as others sleep. They keep awake. They are sober. They are not ignorant or controlled by anything other than the Spirit of God. They live, as one commentator stated, they live with a steady, ready life. What would our lives look like if we live with this type of steady, ready life? And for whatever reason, I always think about the proverb of there's a lion in the street. And then I think about how the language is used regarding the roaring lion that's kind of walking around, slinking around, seeking to destroy us. Men, women, boys, girls, students, what would it be like if every morning you woke up with an awareness of the fact there was an enemy of your soul that wants to destroy you? Now, what if I told you that was a physical enemy and he was going to jump on you whenever you take the trash out? Would that impact the way that you took the trash out? Hey, we're in Texas. I know how some of you men would come out of the house and some of you women would come out of the house. Loaded to bear. You would. You'd have every gun in a window. I know this is true because we're scrambling for ammunition now. Like, it's the reality of it. If the economy falls, we're going to trade 9mm shells. So keeping that in mind, you know, like that's kind of what we're working through here. Don't act like, oh, you know, I just kind of live my life the way I normally live it. You would live differently. And now here's the greatest realization. Here's the wake-up moment. This is where I'm turning the light on. If you think right now that the threat's not actually here yet, you are already asleep and you are already drunk. Man, if you're not guarding your marriages because the temptation hasn't shown up already, You are already falling asleep. You are already drinking of the world's wisdom. Wake up to the reality of what we are threatened with in this world. Be sober-minded, ready, living with an anticipation that he's coming. My life ought to look different. Are you saying legalistically? Of course I'm not. Am I saying that the ready life is what saves you? No, I'm saying that the saved life looks ready for the return of the King. It does not get wrapped up and so concerned and worked up over civilian affairs, but it is faithful to the mission of the commander who says, I'm coming back, be ready. So when we read these terms, awake and sober, we recognize that Paul is primarily using them in a spiritual sense. And this is not to suggest he doesn't have physical notions here. He obviously thinks that drunkenness is a sin. But he's really focusing not on physical awake or physical sobriety, but rather a sobriety of the mind, a wakefulness of the spirit, while discerning the signs of the times that sees the day of the Lord drawing near and that eagerly longs for the day of Christ appearing. Could you say that? I eagerly long for the day of Christ appearing. I find that many of our brothers and sisters that are suffering and struggling, especially brothers and sisters that live in other countries that are under government regimes that are not favorable to their faith, they long for the day of Jesus' return. They long for the day where all wrongs will be made right. If you've been deeply wronged and sinned against, you long for the day when justice will truly be served, because you know that any sense of justice within this world right now is simply rough and unsatisfactory at the end of the day. Those who belong to the day, that is, those who are children of light, they live in the light. They do not fulfill the deeds of the flesh, that is, the deeds of the night, the deeds of darkness, which is the point of verses 7 through 8. Those that live in the light live differently. For we've put on faith, love, hope like armor. And because we've put on faith, love, and hope in Christ, we do not fear the day of the Lord. Why? Because we're already told in verses 9 through 10, we have not been destined to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. As believers, we ought to have hope both in life and in death. While we are alive, we live with a readiness for the day of the Lord. We long for the day of his appearing. We pray for the day of his return, saying, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." We do not set our hope and our security on the things of this world. We do not look to health, wealth, prosperity, or politics for hope, happiness, or satisfaction in this world. We live with our eyes open to the realities of heaven, knowing that one day Christ will return, he will make all things right, he will vindicate his people, and he will judge those who refuse to acknowledge him as Lord and Savior in this life. We who have hoped in Christ do not fear the day of his return. We look forward to it. We anticipate it. We do not fear because we know that the one that is returning loves us and he gave himself for us. We're like a bride, are we not? As Paul would describe it, like a bride that is waiting for the appearing of her good groom, her loving, self-sacrificing groom. And we do not fret over the thought of his anger because he is not angry. He is full of joy. We know he loves us. He cannot wait to see us, and we cannot wait to see him. That's how you feel about the return of Jesus, right? You're encouraged that he's returning, right? You're longing for the day when the heavens open and we meet him in the air, right? You do not believe that you will be deprived of something in this life if he returns before you get to complete some things on your bucket list, do you? Have you ever said things like that? I have. You don't have to raise your hands. I'm just going to be guilty in corporate solidarity with all of you. I hope I get to do that before Christ returns. As if when Christ returns, I will be deprived of a joy that does not match what I would have enjoyed had he not returned yet. Look, I am sure that it is a thrill to play golf at Pebble Beach. For those of you that don't know what I'm talking about, I don't know how to help you. I got nothing for you. I'm trying to come up with something on the fly. It's a really beautiful golf course on the West Coast. I would love to play Pebble Beach before I die, which is before I see Jesus. As if when I see Jesus, I will look back on my life and go, you know, it's really good to see you, Lord, but I wish there were a few things I could have done before this. Oh, no. We long for the appearing. we long to see him? Do we recognize that his return will not be an interruption in our plans? Are you ready? The Apostle Paul wrote to ready his church for the return of Jesus. He wrote to remind them that this world was not their home. He wrote to make sure that they did not get too comfortable in the waiting room. Whatever permanence we may feel in this life must be evaluated in light of eternity. Whatever things that we are hoping for, hoping in, focusing on, and finding our identity in, must ultimately be submitted to the Lordship of Christ. Does your life reflect this heavenly perspective? Can you, with Paul's audience, say, I am ready. I believe that I am not destined for wrath when he returns, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. If you can say, yes, I'm so ready, there are two things that I would like to leave you with today that come right out of the passage. The first is this. These are the implications. If you can say, I am ready, the first implication would be resolve to be ready. Resolve to be ready for the Lord's return. And what I mean by resolving is to think deeply upon it. You may be ready this morning, but walk out and before the end of the day may be thinking again of kind of having a bucket list mentality about your life. And by the way, not beating up on your bucket list. Have those things, enjoy those things. Just keep them in perspective. You will be a much happier person if your ultimate joy and satisfaction is found in Christ and not his gifts. Enjoy his gifts by all means, but in light of him as the giver of all good things. Enjoy him ultimately. Which means you're going to have to resolve to think deeply to be ready for the Lord's return. And then the second implication and point that I would make is encourage fellow believers with this truth. Encourage fellow believers with this truth. And some of you are going to go, well, that's wonderful. And some of you are going to go, okay, I'm not willing to admit this, but now that you say that I should be encouraging people with this truth, and I didn't get permission, but one of our dear sisters that's here today, that's a very accomplished writer and minister in her own right, post on Twitter with great regularity, we are one day closer to seeing Jesus. And that is a wonderful reminder that gives us great comfort and that we ought to encourage others with, but our tendency at times is going to be, wow, if I start saying that to people, they're going to really think that I believe that a resurrected man is going to come out of the sky one day. They're going to think I'm a little bit strange. I'm going to encourage you to lean into that. I'm going to encourage you to not only embrace the reality that you believe that Jesus lived and that Jesus died and that Jesus rose again, but that one day this Jesus that rose again, that ascended on high, is going to return again one day. And as wild as that seems to the modern mind, the postmodern mind, that you actually believe that there's a God that is going to return and he's going to make all things right and he's going to redeem and be reconciled fully and completely to those that have trusted him, and then he's going to judge the world. You really believe that? You will be labeled just as they were. Encourage one another with this truth. This is encouraging. This is encouraging to know that things are not going to remain the way they are right now. There is going to be reconciliation. There is going to be healing. There is going to be a new heaven and a new earth and a new Jerusalem. I love the way that Paul writes in verse 10. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, and I would love to go into the asleep there because he's not saying spiritually asleep. He's speaking of how believers have fallen asleep in Christ in verses 13 through 18 in verse chapter 4. So if we were reading all the way through the book, that's what you would see here. The idea, though, is he goes on to say, whether you're awake or asleep, so whether you're alive or you have died in Christ, we may live together with him. Heaven is the enjoyment of him forever in his presence, to see his glory, to be changed completely in the blink of an eye. And he says, encourage one another with this. Some of you are at the end of your rope. Some of you are struggling. Some of you are understandably fearful, worried. You're in pain. You're in sorrow. And Paul wants you to be encouraged. The pain, the real, is temporary. And there's coming a day when all wrongs will be right. And every tear will be wiped away. And every disease will be healed. And the dead in Christ shall rise and reign and live with him forever. And if that is our destiny because of Christ, brothers and sisters, we can endure. We can hold on because he is faithful. Now, I said those are the two things that if you said you're ready, that applies to you. But what if you're not a believer today and you said, I'm not ready? Is there any good news for me? There is. The good news for you is that he's not returned yet. And you know why he hasn't returned yet, according to 2 Peter? It's because he's patient with you. And he doesn't desire for you to perish. Now, some of you may be thinking to yourself, you know, I don't believe in all this Jesus stuff. I come because my mom makes me come. I come because my boyfriend, my girlfriend makes me come. I come because my wife makes me come. I come because I want people to think well of me. I really just don't believe. I can't believe that you would think that. You're crazy. Why did they let people like you have a driver's license and vote? You believe that? Paul told the church in Thessalonica to be ready, and he still hasn't returned. Maybe he was wrong. Or maybe the reason why Jesus has not returned yet is because of what we find in 2 Peter 3. 2 Peter 3, verse 8. But do not forget this one thing, dear friend. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. The Lord is not slow to keep his promise, as some understand slowness. So some of you are thinking, he's not returning, he hasn't returned yet. So I don't have to do anything because this whole thing's a farce. It's not true. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. What you think is proof that he's not real, and what you say, that's the reason I don't believe, is because he hasn't returned yet, is actually proof that he's better than you recognize he is, and the reason he hasn't returned just yet is because he's patient with you, because he would rather welcome you as a child than crush you as an enemy when he does return. So what if this morning you laid down the arms of rebellion and you said, I want to be ready? If you want to be ready, why don't you close with me in prayer? What do I do? You admit that you're a sinner in need of God's mercy. You believe that God sent Jesus to die in your place under his wrath so that you might be set free from it. And you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You could pray something like this. God, I recognize, I know I'm a sinner. I know that you are holy, and I need you to have mercy upon me. I believe that Jesus did live, that he did die, and that he did rise again, that he did ascend into heaven, and that he is going to return, and that he is Savior and Lord over all, and that he is my only hope. And Lord God, I'm asking for you to save me, to cause me to be born again. If you have prayed that, and you have called upon the name of the Lord, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, those of you that have prayed that and asked for God to save you and to make you ready for that day, that you might be like the citizens of heaven that are awaiting the return of their king. If that's you, on the screen behind me, you will see a number that you can text the word pray to. If you text that word pray to that number, someone in our church will get in touch with you in the next few hours to help you take the next step of following Jesus. We want to help you. We want you to know that God is a patient God who does not want to see any perish, but all to come to hope in him through Christ. Lord God, would you, just in your kind, sweet mercy toward us, help us, Lord, to be ready. Set our minds, set our affections upon heaven. Help us, Lord God. Awaken us, sober us up to the coming of Christ, that we might live with a wakefulness and sobriety that honors you day to day until that day. In Jesus' holy name that we pray, in the name that's above every name, amen. I would invite you to turn your attention to our screens for a giving testimony.
Well, good morning. My name is Ruben Salcedo, and I'm a deacon here at Copperfield Church. So right about this time is the time that we'd like for you to start preparing to give. There's a couple of different ways that you could give here at Copperfield. If you're here with us, one of the ways you could give is by using the envelopes that are located by the doors. You could put your offering in there and drop it on or drop it off on your way out. If you're online or if you want to give via your cell phone, you can always text 84321. You can go to copperfield.church and put in your offering that way. So, again, different avenues for you to give to the church. If you can now, please bow your head so we can pray for the offering. Lord, Father, we're grateful for all that you've given us. Lord, we ask that you open up our hearts, Lord, to give with a humble heart. We ask that you take the blessings that we offer to you today to help expand your kingdom, Lord. We know there's people that need you, and let us be your hands and feet to accomplish this. It's in your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
Amen. If you would stand for our benediction. Benediction comes from Revelation 22, verses 16 through 21. Jesus speaking through John. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride says, come, and let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this scroll, if anyone adds anything to them, God will add to that person the plagues described in this scroll. And if anyone takes away from the words in this scroll of prophecy, God will take away that person, their share in the tree of life in the holy city, which are described in this scroll. He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. Be blessed. You are dismissed. Have a wonderful day.
Hey, friends. Welcome back.
Welcome.
So, great service, man. Great message.
Yes.
Thank you, Pastor Casey. What do you think?
Very timely. Very timely. I think, you know, a lot of people may be nervous about Tuesday for different reasons, and I think there's going to be a lot of check boxes. You know, you got to use your own personal conviction, however you feel led to vote there. But there is one big box that is much more important than all that, right. And that's whether or not you believe Jesus is our personal Lord and Savior.
Yeah.
And really, that's what matters most. And all those other check boxes, it's this world and not that world.
Yeah. Man, the biggest thing that got to me is, like, are you ready today?
Yeah.
If he showed up, like, are you living like you're expecting him to come in,
yep,
and come today, right? So, you know, question out to everybody else. Are you living that way? Are you ready? Are you ready for Jesus to come today? And, you know, is your heart open and waiting for him?
And if you have any other comments or thoughts on the message today, please
absolutely
message us on the Facebook live feed.
Yeah, post them on there. We'll respond. You know, we'd love to engage with you guys. Any questions you may have, if you need to reach out to the staff in the church, post them on there as well if you have questions about the message. If you don't know Christ and you want to know more about Christ, please message us. And yeah, we'd be happy to talk to you about that all day, 7 days a week. Does not have to be on Sundays.
And one other thing he said, you know, I hope I get to do that before,
yeah,
Christ returns. I don't know about you, but I've definitely have had that thought before. I'm getting better at it, but
yeah.
I don't know if you have had that.
Yeah, I hope to. I hope Casey invites me to play at Pebble Beach with him, actually. So when he mentioned it, I was expecting an invitation following that.
Oh, so your plan is to to get better at golf?
It is.
That point?
It is. Hopefully.
Because you just talked about how you were not.
Well, you know.
You might be wasting on such a great place.
It's okay. It's a beautiful place. So, you know, the atmosphere, just the
wind. It'll make it better. No matter how you play.
I will play better in, you know, allow me the opportunity. Guaranteed, I will play better while I'm there. So, hopefully you guys got something out of the sermon. Thank you all for being with us. Time to prepare for Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, and real quick, thanks, Jack. You guys look like David and Goliath.
I'm glad you guys didn't say twins, you know. Maybe most people don't know the movie. Do you know the movie? You know the movie Twins?
Yeah.
Okay.
Schwarzenegger
and Danny DeVito?
Yeah.
So that's pretty awesome because I know twins like that. But so thank you guys for joining with us. Jack, thanks for eating 3-pound burgers for us.
Yeah, we appreciate that.
We appreciate that. I don't think I can do that anymore. I won't be able to get out of bed for about a week or two.
But you need more 3-pound burgers so you continue to look like The Rock.
That's true. I mean, that's how I put on
all that muscle.
The LBs, as my buddy used to say. So don't forget, Sunday, November 15th, between 11 and 2, please come join us. It'll be a great time. We will be there.
Grateful on the Green.
Yeah, Grateful on the Green or Grateful on the Grounds. As Casey said, whatever name you want it, okay? Ground Green. Green Grounds.
Casey can call it whatever he wants.
Yeah. We'll call it Green because Pam put that on our notes.
Yeah. So we follow Pam's rules.
We do. We're more scared of Pam than we are Casey, so we're going to go for that.
So, and then also the Lake Travis volunteer event to help with those houses that and families that have been affected by the storms there. So that should be coming up mid-November, so don't forget about that and be on the lookout for that final date and how to get involved with that.
Absolutely. So thank you all for coming. Tell your friends about the virtual atrium. Invite them out for next Sunday. 10:35 it starts. We'll come on at 10:40. We forgot to mention earlier, but we do come on a little bit after the sermon. She's kind of debrief and talk about things and just bring these announcements home. But if you have questions, comments, please put them on the Facebook app and we'll get back to you. Thank you all for joining us. Have a great day.
said, only love can drive out all the darkness. What are we fighting for? Yeah, we were made to carry one another. We were made for more. We all bleed the same. We're more beautiful when we come together.
Father God, I pray that our families will come together right now and seek your face. You will forgive our sins and you'll heal our incredible land. In the name of the only Savior, Jesus Christ.
Go get him.
Amen.
Wrong way. Where are you going?
They didn't know the scripture. For now, we have women understand and know the scripture. So try to pull out that context and say, well,
who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Who is free. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good.
Say, don't give up, and hope that your good is good enough. Head down, keep on working. If you can earn it, you deserve it. Yeah. Some say, push on through. After all, it's the least that you can do. But don't buy what they're selling. Couldn't be further from the truth. What if I were the one to tell you? News ever. Some say don't ask for help. God helps the ones who help themselves. So press on, get it right. Otherwise, get left behind. Yeah. Some say he's keeping score. So try.
could never lose my hope. I've been down this road before. Now I know which way to go. You can try to drag me down, but I'll be living in the clouds. Everybody has their doubts, but you can't stop now. You just gotta live.
I want it like I need to breathe, yeah. Make it clear like I need to see. As a kid, mama told me sky's the limit till you hit it. Like King Griffey to the fences, out of there. Out the park, hit and run, that's my drive. That's my drive, it's a vibe, been that way all my life, yeah. I shut it down when I shine with the truth. Yeah, I ride with the crew, gave my life to the truth. Testify, walk on water like the son of man. Understand, I'll never drown. Take a hit, never quit. Down but never out. There are days that I fail, and the train's off the rail. Through the pain we prevail. Tell them you just gotta live.
Even when my life burns low, I could never lose my hope. I've been down this road before. Now I know which way to go. You can try to drag me down, but I'll be living in the clouds. Everybody has, but you can't stop now. You just gotta live. You just gotta live. You just gotta live. Even when my life burns low, I could never lose my hope. You just gotta live. Everybody has their doubts, but you can't stop now.
Live until there's nothing left. Lean on. We need you like there's no one else. Ain't nobody out here more like you. And with you that broke the mold, and ain't no more like you. That for sure. I can't drop out like the top down on the coupe. Tell them watch out when I walk, I make a move. Sunday morning with my hands up, like they got the handcuffs. Searching for some answers since mama passed. Cancer and my sister left Seattle with a one-way ticket home. Hope she holdin' Chase and teaching him to speak some more. Gotta keep it going. Yeah, that's all he told me. Tell him you can make it when you know the one and only.
Burning bright beyond the fire. You were born to win, yeah, you're a fighter. Don't let your light just fade away. You just gotta leave.
It's a mama singing songs about the Lord. It's a daddy spending family time the world says he cannot afford. These simple moments change the world. It's a pastor at a tiny little church. 40 years of loving on the broken and the hurt. These simple moments change the world. Dream small. Don't buy the lie, you've gotta do it all. Just let Jesus use you where you are. One day at a time, live well. Loving God and others as yourself. Find little ways where only you can help. With His great love, a tiny rock can make a giant fall. Dream small. On a Friday with your friend with special needs. These
simple moments change the world. Of course, there's nothing wrong with bigger dreams. Just don't miss the minutes on your way to bigger things. No, 'cause these simple moments change the world. So dream small. Don't buy the lie, you've gotta do it all. Just let Jesus use you where you are. One day at a time, live well. Loving God and others as yourself. Find little ways where only you can help. With His great love, a tiny rock can make a giant fall. So dream small. Keep loving, keep serving, keep listening, keep learning, keep praying, keep hoping, keep seeking, keep searching. Out of the small things and watch them grow bigger. The God who does all things makes oceans from rivers. So dream small. Don't buy the lie, you've gotta do it all. Just let Jesus use you where you are. One day at a time, live well. Loving God and others as yourself. Find little ways where only you can help. With His great love, a tiny rock can make a giant fall. Yeah, find loaves and two fish can feed them all. So dream small. Dream small.